Hello, Malty Maguires. Ralphie here with Whisky Review 298, part of a little series on young world whiskies. But before I tell you all about this whisky here, called Sullivan's Cove, I must give credit to the malt mentioner who provided the malt mention that did get a mention. And I hope I'm going to pronounce this correctly. Sometimes it can be a little bit awkward, but here we go. For help. Right, I think I've got that right. Moving on. World whisky is generally interesting and exciting. There are some rough stuff options out there, but there are also some relatively young whiskies which are significantly better in quality than they were a few years ago. Sullivan's Cove, good example. This is cask strength Tasmanian whisky. I do tend to keep Tasmania and Australia separate for a very practical reason, because the Australian whiskies I have tasted have a different character to the Tasmanian whiskies that I've tasted. Tasmanian whiskies, fruity, rich, textured, gutsy. Australian whiskies, more resinous, more dry, more of a subtle complexity, a kind of hard to pin down complexity. It's early days yet, I could change my mind in this, but I won't be changing my mind about the quality of this one. Well worth reviewing as I remove a screw top. How refreshing from a bottle of single malt, a screw top. It's the Bourbon matured cask strength version of Sullivan Cove. They don't produce a lot, it's just a small operation under the address of Tasmania Distillery, if you want to look it up. It says cask strength on the tub, and that means in this case 60% volume. Good big beefy strength of alcohol there, carrying plenty of flavour. A word of advice, Sullivan's Cove, and all you small distillers, I get the impression that there's no additional colourant been added in the form of E150A, and I also get the impression, having added water to this whisky and watched it go slightly cloudy, that hasn't been chill filtered either. May I humbly suggest to all you global world whisky producers, state it clearly on your labels that you don't add colouring and you don't chill filter. People who are buying your whisky will probably want to know this, because it means that generally they're getting a better quality product. So there you have it. Sullivan's Cove started about 1994, very small operation, a place called Cambridge, near Hobart, allegedly the site where the first British invaders landed in Tasmania a few years before completely wiping out the indigenous population. A little bit of, you know, there's things in history that tend to get written out and forgotten about and brushed under the carpet, and I like to find out these things. What's interesting about Tasmania, and one reason that Tasmanian whisky has a different character to Australian whisky, is that the environment is so different. Whereas Australia generally has a water shortage, it's a big, dry, very hot country. Tasmania is much more wet. It has good conditions for growing barley. It has significant peat reserves for getting fuel for peating the whisky, and the water is of excellent quality. So Tasmania, even more so than Australia, has the ideal components for producing good quality whisky. And even better, Tasmania is very much prominent in the renaissance of Tasmanian Australian whiskies, which are happening right at this moment in time. Other Tasmanian distilleries include Lark, Hellier's Road. Yep, there's a few others as well, but those are the two that spring to mind at the moment. While I'm chatting, by the way, I'm just letting the water that I've added to this whiskey mellow it down, open it up. Age, there's no age stated in this. I'll hold the bottle up so you can see it, because it's quite a dark label. I was going to say dull label. To a certain extent, it is a bit, but... For the anoraks amongst you, by the way, this is barrel HH0199, bottle, it was 126 bottles, it's signed by a P. Maguire by the looks of it, barrel date March 2000 and bottle date January 2010, so a 9 year old whisky. Good stuff. Are still relatively young by Scotch standards, but quite mature, taking on a little bit of age by Australian Tasmanian standards. And I think that's of interest to me, because it gives me an idea, having tasted Sullivan's Cove before, and have to be honest, being totally disappointed. What the last one of the tastes a few years ago was not good, but there's a reason for that. Here we are. This is kind of a few years in the cask. Beautiful, fresh, almost effervescent, sherbety, fruity nose. This is fantastic. It really is. Good initial impression. Has a bit of a checkered career, Sullivan's Cove, in that it's had several changes of ownership. In fact, it was closed down for 2 years at the beginning of the 21st century. But it has gone from a fairly poor reputation to an exceedingly excellent reputation, and I think actually it can only even get better as time goes on. Interestingly, and I'll mention this because I think it's important, is that world whisky producers, whether in Australia or Timbuktu or wherever, are starting off with relative inexperience, trying to mimic the Scottish way of doing things, and it is only with experience, and you cannot beat experience in whatever you're distilling. Personal experience is absolutely key. They are adjusting things to suit the local situation, the local environment, and their own way of working, understanding far better than they have in the past just what puts the quality in the bottle. And I certainly, Sullivan's Cove here and now in 2012 is shouting that out. Nose. Complex, beautiful, rich, fresh fruit and toffee. Effervescent barley, touch of ginger, hints of clove, hints of cinnamon. Busy, busy nose this. Chocolate, milk chocolate, fudge, vanilla, spicy. It's a spiciness in that clove. It's part wood spice note that's in here. Hints of smoke, and then an earthiness. That defining character of Australia and Tasmania. That clay note, which really stands out in this bottling. Really enjoying that, and it really is. That note is only coming through now and becoming prominent because the whisky is now being bottled at 9 years old instead of 3 or 4, where it's still hidden in the new make spirit. I've seen exactly the same thing happen with Isle of Arran Distillery. It starts off bland, ubiquitous, uninteresting malt, hits a certain age, starts to sparkle. In the case of the Isle of Arran, it was 12 years old. With Sullivan's Cove, certainly at 9 years old, it's starting to really happen, and it's got further to go. Excellent. Taste. neat. It's pretty heavy duty, being 60%. It's as full bodied as Aberlour Abernah. However, I've added some water. I've given this a minute or two to settle down and open up and do its stuff. Let's see how we get on. Tangy. Got a lovely gingery note to it. And again, the earthiness is coming through in the flavour. Still spirity, but there's a sweetness and there's a lovely wood influence going on, not too harsh and bitter. And I think that Australian distillers generally have been coming much more wood aware as to what casks specifically suit their environment, rather than just using casks that would be fine in Scotland. Or they've become, they're tailoring things to suit themselves much better. Toffee, spicy, wood rich, aromatic, spice notes, a lot of complexity, hint of smoke, brown sugar, soft, very soft, coriander, vanilla, almonds, so there's a kind of soft nuttiness involved here. And interestingly, one of the features of this is that the first impression, first taste is of sweetness. And like Highland Park, it moves into a drier, more tannic area of in terms of taste. Vanilla there, banana. Cream banana sweets. Ice cream, touch of apricot, lychee. There's no particular flavours really jump out at you. It really is a great big fruit basket, not just of fruit flavours, but of other things in there. The nuts, there's some dried fruit, some dried apricot slices, some banana candy, that sort of stuff. I've got a note here. Finish, honey, bitter oak and various Indian teas. Interesting one that. So we're getting a bit of substance to the finish on this whiskey, which is tends to be missing from a lot of the young and immature world whiskies, although their arrivals are really quite sound. But a prolonged, complex, layered development of spices and aromatic woods layered with honey. Good stuff. In fact, malt marks, 90, yeah, out of 100. And that is a Tasmanian malt mark. Excellent stuff. However, as the proverbial saying says, there's a fly in the ointment, and it is simple. In the European market, imported world whiskies tend to be expensive. Japanese whiskies are expensive, but when you've got 15-year-old, 17-year-old Japanese whiskey, which is displaying the complexity and maturity of a 21 or 25-year-old Scotch, you don't mind paying that bit extra. But in the case of Australian whiskies and Tasmanian whiskies, you're talking three times the price of your Scotch equivalent. And this is such, it's the price. And I don't kind of like to dwell on the cost of whiskies, because we look at the price wherever we are and we make the decision, I'll buy that or I won't buy that. Affordable, achievable, or simply too expensive. But I feel that the high price of Australian whiskies in Europe and arguably elsewhere around the world are partly down to the fact that the Australian government, and I'm giving a personal perspective here, the Australian government do not take their whisky industry seriously. They do not give much support or backing to the whisky industry, or they do not take the lobby from the Australian whisky industry too seriously. The wine industry in Australia is far more influential, powerful and supported. In fact, I could be wrong, but I suspect that the Australian wine industry pays proportionally less taxes than the Australian and Tasmanian whisky industries. And I think that something's being missed here by the Australian government, because the ore for the Chinese market is not going to last forever. So they've really got to be looking ahead and looking well ahead. And I think it would be a very sound economic investment by the Australian authorities to take the whisky industry, the spirits industry, more seriously, and perhaps even looking to promote cooperation between the whisky producers and the wine industry to kickstart a cognac, brandy, Armagnac industry based in Australia. Just an idea, just a suggestion. I'm just thinking aloud, but that's one of the things I do. Anyway, good stuff. Sullivan's Cove used to be called disparagingly Sullivan's Socks by some of the whisky insiders, and it was not taken seriously. And unfortunately, it kind of dented the collective reputation, because these things happen, of the regional production in Tasmania. But boy, things have changed. More distilleries are opening. Good luck to them. When Scotch is what you're really used to, what you're very familiar with, and what you use as your benchmark for reviewing world whiskies, I can honestly say that it's something that's different from Scotch, not just in terms of flavour, but in terms of nature and character. Getting to know that, getting a different whisky experience, is really enjoying that, and it's something that will be mentioned in my third and final Young World Whisky Review series, 299. I'll try that again, will I? My goodness, this is me sober. I've hardly even had a drop yet. 299, yes. Three ships. That's it up there. South Africa. I'm going to tell you all about it. Interesting experience I had with that one. Bit of a roller coaster, actually. But not much of a roller coaster with this one. This was more a very pleasant trip on the merry-go-round. Yeah. See you back again soon at ralphie.com. where whisky stuff happens on video for your infotainment. See you soon.